Grace Church, let's stand to our feet this morning. It's wonderful to see you. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life." And that's what we declare this morning. May the word of Christ warm our hearts on this cold, cold morning. Let's sing this out. Come on.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
Here we go.
For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Is waiting there with open arms. See his open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Seated this morning. We're going to just keep things going and worship, but we're also going to dedicate some of our children this morning. Pastor Travis is coming. So here we go.
Good morning, Grace Church. My name is Pastor Travis Armstrong, Director of Family Ministries here at Grace, and I tell you, it's an absolute honor to stand here today as we once again recognize the importance of doing a child dedication. Psalm 145 says this, "Great is the Lord. He is most worthy of praise. Let each generation tell its children of his mighty acts. Let them proclaim his power." Y'all, in essence, that's what we're committed to as a church. Knowing the greatness of God and then making him known to the next generation. But where it all begins is with the family. So let's meet these wonderful parents and these most precious children that are being dedicated. First, we have over to my right, your left, this is Calvin Lee Berry, son of Ryan and Caitlin Berry. And then we have Jeremiah Luke Johnson, son of Jaleel and Amy Johnson. So good to see you guys. Next, we have Jordan Thomas Mattson, son of Bob and Annie Mattson. And this is Olivia Dana McClung, daughter of Jeremy and Dana McClung. So cute. And here we have Gunnar J. Moberg, son of Natalie Moberg. Next, we have Lane Arthur Maurer, son of Grayson Maurer. Hey, bud. And this is Mia Rosalind Morozov, daughter of Maxim and Angelina Morozov. And then we have Obadiah Richard Schmidt, son of Matt and Rachel Schmidt. Emery Joy Atayan. Parents are Zach and Allery. Precious. Next we have Daniel Kent Barella, son of Chris and Jen Barella. So glad you guys are here today. And thirdly, we have Rory Ann Erickson, daughter of Matt and Katie Erickson. And then we have Daniel Lawrence Johansson, son of Jeff and Claire Johansson. Last but not least, Jack Kawada Paul, son of Jack and Amy Paul. Well, parents, we're so glad you're here today. You know, in Deuteronomy 6, God gives Moses what, in a sense, is the family discipleship game plan for passing on the faith from one generation to the next. Let me read this very familiar passage to you as you follow along. It says this in Deuteronomy 6, 4 to 7. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your might. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise up. Parents, as a church, we want to let you know that we love you, we are for you, and we support you in your commitment to raise your kids for God's glory. You know, today as a church, one of the best ways we can come alongside and support you is through prayer. And so, Grace, if you would you just extend a hand and let's pray for these amazing families. Jesus, we thank you for the gift of children. Our good Father gives us great gifts. One of those is the family, children. Children, I pray, would be raised in a home where they come to know Christ from an early age because mom and dad are immersing them in the scriptures, that they too might trust in you. Thank you that the very first small group you ever created was the family. And as a church, we come alongside them today that they might know they're not alone in this wonderful adventure called parenting. And so, Father, we pray your grace upon them, and thank you, Jesus, that that's extended to us. And we know that every single time we see the cross, God's demonstration towards us of his great love while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Thank you for the gospel and for these families. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all, put your hands together. Let's press some love for these families. Thank you guys so much. Thank you. Thank you. Well, let's continue together in worship this morning.
It's just powerful to see families standing together to raise their children in the truth of Christ. Let's stand together and we'll continue to sing this morning. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. We declare that together.
You are in Christ alone. Oh.
I've just been convicted about some of that lately, like just having fear and anxiety, and really just almost the thought, it's really a lie, but just the thought that I can control it, you know. And so there's certain things I just don't give to Jesus, and we really should, you know. He can handle all of that stuff. The Bible says to cast our cares on him, for he cares for us. You know, so I was just reading this story this week, and it just kind of reminded me, you know, the disciples, like, we're a lot like them in a lot of ways. You know, before the resurrection, these dudes were scared of everything all the time, you know. And I think the conviction there for me is, like, I'm like that so much. You know, after the resurrection, we see these men who are just strong, and they're fearless, and they seem to know what they believe, and they believe it, and they're willing to die for it, and they did. But so often, I think we can just be like this. I know I can. Mark 4, starting in 35, says, "On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, 'Let us go across to the other side.' And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. And other boats were with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him and said to him, 'Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?' And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, 'Peace, be still.' And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said to them, 'Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?' And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, 'Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?'"
Jesus, Jesus, Thanks for coming today. It's good to see you. Hey, listen, if you are a first-timer here with us today, would you just kind of slip your hand up so I can just kind of see? Man, would you welcome those if you're here for the first time today? Thanks so much for coming today. Like, we do appreciate it. And if you're new to this whole, like, church scene thing and you're like, man, what is this all about? You pick up really quickly that the focal point is always a person by the name of Jesus, right? And that Jesus is in control of every facet of life. Most importantly, he's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is God Almighty, and he loves you. And he wants to know you. He wants to forgive your sins. He wants you to be in relationship with him forever. Amen? So today we're going to study God's Word together. So if you would, turn your Bibles with me to 1 Peter chapter 4. You find it in your Bible, find it on your device, whatever works for you. 1 Peter chapter 4. So I'm going to pray for us and let's jump in to the Word together today. God, thank you so much for your Word. Thank you that it's true. Whatever it is today that we don't know and that you want us to know, would you teach us and tell us whatever it is that we don't have that would make us more like you, would you give that to us today? And whatever it is that we're not today and you want to change us and transform us, would do your work in us. We're open to it today. So we want you to speak to us, change us, transform us, and help us to understand what it means to know Jesus Christ more fully today. And I pray this in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. So I was reading some stats this past week, and stats say that people spend, now think about this, people spend nearly 2 years of their lives making phone calls to people who don't answer their phones. That's a lot of time, isn't it? Like, spend 2 years of their lives making phone calls to people who don't answer their phones. So answer your phone, all right? Answer your phone, right? Quit screening my calls. So when I call Sherry, I expect her to always answer the phone. And she doesn't answer the phone. I text her, what? Answer your phone so I have something to say. Like, answer your phone, right? This is so important. Stats also say we spend 6 months of our lives at traffic lights waiting for them to turn green. We'll spend another 8 months opening and reading junk mail. Like, are you kidding me, right? We'll spend close to 5 years of our lives waiting in line, grocery lines, etc. I spent like 5 years this past week waiting at Costco in line. There's like long lines, right? And I could go like on and on and on about all the crazy ways that we spend our time. But the truth is that you know this, right? You're already fully aware of this, right? The time is something that we all think a lot about already. Like, we all have numerous devices that help us to know what time it is, to be on time. People love it when a pastor ends on time. So I know, like, you've got like a mental clock in your head when this thing should end. I know that. We have increments of time, right? We have seconds and hours and days and weeks and months all combined to make a year. Moreover, I don't know if you know this or not, but the average lifespan of an American is 78 and a half years of time. And here's the thing, right? When you're young, like, we all assume when we're young, right, that we have like oodles of time. Like, you got so much time that time is like on your side. You don't even worry about time, right? You have so much of it in front of you. But when you get a little bit older, right, you realize that you don't have so much time. You also realize that time is fleeting. It is like racing by. And so my admonition to you is this: be really cognizant of this commodity that God has given you called time. Thoreau once said this: you can't kill time without injuring eternity. So, like, time matters. We should care deeply about the limited amount of time that we have on earth. Now, a lot of people think that when Peter wrote 1 Peter, that he believed that his time on earth was like almost up. Like literally he's writing thinking that, man, martyrdom is right around the corner. And so he gives us a real gift today. Like, he writes with a great insight and urgency and passion about ways to strategically spend time, about ways for us to think about how we wisely spend the limited amount of time that we actually have on earth. So let's see what he says today. Let's stand together, honor of God's word. 1 Peter chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. Peter writes this: since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. I'll explain that in a moment. Verse 2. So as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, lawless, idolatry. Verse 4, with respect to this, they're surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you. But they will give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. Verse 6, for this is why the gospel was preached even to those who are dead, that though judged in the flesh the way people are, they might live in the spirit the way God does. This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. This is another complicated section of scripture that, if we don't explain it, you can really fall prey to some erroneous theology along the way. But I want you to see this little phrase in verse 1. This little phrase, arm yourselves. Like, I would circle that phrase, underline that phrase. It is a military phrase that means to be prepared. So picture, if you will, a soldier like putting on his or her gear and getting ready to head into battle. That's the idea here. And so Peter says, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. So he's kind of tipping us off here that a certain kind of mentality is required. Right, as we think about what he's going to talk about today, like we got to get our head in the game. We might say it that way: like, get your head in the game, right? Get your mind ready for the battle. Get mentally prepared for the fight. And so Peter says, as you think about time, right, you need to process, right, be mentally ready with what you're going to do with and how you're going to spend your time. If you're going to live strategically and wisely in culture, because you don't want to waste time because you know it's limited, what do you do? Well, Peter gives us some specifics here of how to spend our time wisely. And the first thing that he says to us is this: if you want to spend your time wisely, number one, resist sin. Like, here's a way to spend time wisely: resist sin. Look at verse 2. He says, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions. So Peter says, with the remaining time that you have on earth, like don't waste your time. Don't waste your time on sin, right? Arm yourselves, get yourself mentally prepared for how you're going to think about the limited amount of time you have, and don't waste your time on sin. So he essentially says, like, we need a militant attitude towards sin. We need like an aggressive stand against sin. Like, we can never get like used to sin. We can never get like comfortable with sin. And here's the truth. If you don't make time to battle sin or to resist sin in your life, what will sin do? Sin will steal time from your life. How many of you understand? Sin actually robs us of all kinds of time. So, for example, sin steals quality time from marriages and families, right? Sin steals time from young people. When you're young, you can make decisions when you're young. You can fall prey to sin when you're young, and it can thrust you into adulthood where you miss all this time that you could have enjoyed your youth and your younger years. It can thrust you into adulthood, ready or not. Like, sin can thrust you into like a downward spiral that takes years to recover from. Right, think about it. You can like spend years building up a business. You can spend years building up a reputation. And if you fall into sin, you've wasted all of those years that you took to build your business, to build your integrity, to build your character, to build your reputation. And so Peter says, listen, you got to resist sin, not only because of what it does to you, what it does to me, right, to us, but also because of what it did to Jesus. Like, you see that in verse 1, Christ suffered for us in the flesh. What does Peter do? He continually takes us back to the person of Jesus, and he continually takes us back to the mission of Jesus, where Jesus came to die on the cross for sin. And so when we look at the cross, we get like a front row seat then to what our sin did to Jesus. It's why Peter says, like, arm yourself with the same mind that Jesus had toward sin. So what do we know about Jesus' mindset towards sin, right? He had a militant attitude towards sin, as proven by his steadfast movement toward the cross of Jesus Christ. Like, Jesus came to deal with sin. He came to die on the cross for sin. He never, and you think about this, he never one time wavered from his mission. He came to take away our sins. Now, when Peter says, whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, he's not suggesting, he's not saying that you and I at some juncture in our humanity can finally become or arrive at this place where we're sinless. He's essentially saying, yes, your ultimate goal is to be done with sin, but that's not going to happen, right, while we're on earth. Like, we won't fully conquer sin until we enter into glory, right? That's why we're always reliant upon the cross of Jesus Christ. But what Peter does is he actually gives us a really rich insight here regarding resisting sin and suffering. And so that phrase, for whoever suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, Peter is saying that, like, suffering can actually benefit you and serve you and help you resist sin. Right? Think about this. Like, suffering in the flesh tends to get our attention like nothing else does. Have you noticed that when you're suffering, like you're all ears, right? You're way more attentive to who God is and to what God might be saying. And the truth is that when suffering has our attention, What it does is it strips away things that are worthless, superfluous, and sinful. Like when we suffer, like our priorities tend to get reshuffled and reordered. And so Peter's like, you want to make your time count, then resist sin. Spend your time resisting sin. And then leverage suffering to help you defeat sin. So don't let sin rob you of investing your time wisely. Because that's what sin will do. It'll rob you of spending your time wisely. So don't let sin cause you to waste precious time like loving stuff more than people, like loving the world more than God, loving impurity more than godliness, right? Loving a career more than your children. Don't let sin play you or dominate you like that. The second way, if you look here on your outlines, the second way that Peter says you can spend your time wisely is to make a decision to relish God's will. So here's what Peter does. Peter gets right to the heart of the matter regarding how we should spend our time. Look at the end of verse 2. He says, listen, don't spend the rest of your time in the flesh just like going for it with human passions, but rather focus on what? Focus on the will of God. He says, like, the best way to use your time and to spend your time is by doing the will of God. Like, make the pursuit of God's will your lifelong goal. And I'll tell you, listen, discovering the will of God is the most important and exciting thing about life. I would say this, there's nothing better, there's nothing more gratifying, there is nothing more satisfying than knowing you are in God's will. So somebody once said that the two most important days in your life are knowing the day when you were born and knowing the day or figuring out the day why you were born. And listen, when you know the will of God, then you kind of know your why. Like, what is your why? What is your purpose? When you pursue the will of God, you'll find out why you are on this planet. Now I watch this all the time. I get like a front row seat to this. A lot of Christians get really, I would say, like, flaky when it comes to God's will. And I've heard all kinds of stuff. Like, some people think that you discover God's will by sort of sitting in a corner and just humming and getting an impression, right? Some play roulette with the Bible. So, like, I need to know God's will, so I'm going to trust that the Spirit of God is going to guide my finger to a certain passage in the Bible, and wherever my finger lands, that is the will of God. I would say be super careful doing that, because you may stick your finger on the text that says, and Judas went out and hanged himself. Like, go thou and do likewise. You want to be super careful, like, playing around with the Bible like that. And some people get really, really confused about God's will. So I read a story about a farmer who thought that God wanted him to be an evangelist, wanted him to be a pastor, a preacher. And so he's out working in his field one day when he plops down by the side of a tree and he starts just like staring up reflectively into the sky. And as he looked up in the clouds, he saw the clouds form what looked like to him two large letters, a large P and a large C. And he thought, P-C, P-C. Preach Christ, like, that's it. That's a sign. That's God's will for my life. So he sold his farm and decided that he was going to be a preacher and an evangelist. However, the problem was he was a horrible speaker. He was an absolutely rotten communicator. His preaching was just awful. It was so bad that one of his buddies came up to him after hearing him preach and said this, dude, do you think that maybe God was using PC to tell you to plant corn, not preach Christ? And so here's what I would say, like, don't mysticize God's will, right? Be who God made you to be and celebrate that, right? And be careful not to find God's will, like, on a billboard, like on a license plate or a cloud formation. Because I'm sure there are a lot of us right now, it's like 18 below zero right now. And a lot of us are looking for a sign, right? God, do you want me to continue to live here in Minnesota? And any billboard, any sign, any cloud formation you see is like Arizona, right? Florida. Like you're just looking for something, right? And we do that all the time. So we have to be careful of that. I'd also say don't try and impose your will on God's will. It's kind of like the guy who decided that he was going to go on a diet. And so he told all of his coworkers, listen, I'm going to do this diet thing. You guys got to hold me accountable. And so he rolls into work one day with this humongous coffee cake. And as he strolls into the office with this coffee cake, all of his coworkers are like, dude, what are you doing? Like, hold on here. You're on a diet. You want us to hold you accountable. And he's like, no. This is the will of God for my life. And he said, last week I changed my route to work so that I wouldn't go by the bakery. But today, like I happened to forget, and I drove right by the bakery. And when I drove by the bakery, I saw this huge coffee cake in the window. And I knew it couldn't be an accident, that it was God's providence. And so I pray, God, if it's your will for me to get that coffee cake, make a parking space open up right in front of that bakery. And he said, wouldn't you know it, eighth time around the block, there it was, a parking space, right? Will of God. So don't be flaky, right? Don't be superstitious in pursuing God's will. Don't try to impose your will on God's will. You want to know the best way to know the will of God? The best way to know the will of God is to get in the Word of God, right? So I can tell you the will of God for your life. Here's what God wants. God wants for you to know His Son, Jesus. He does. He wants for you to meet Him. He wants for you to know Him. He wants for you to love Him. He wants you to follow Him. He wants for you to be like Him. And then He wants you to tell everyone on the face of the planet about Him. Like that is the will of God for every single person in this place. And you don't have to be a pastor to do that. You don't have to be an evangelist to do that. You can just be you, right? So being a farmer, right, is not less valuable than being a pastor. You be who you are. You be who God has made you to be. And then you celebrate that. And so Peter's like, listen, if you want to spend your time wisely, here's what you do. You resist sin. Like take it seriously. Number two, you relish, right? You run towards God's will. Thirdly, he says this, you want to spend your time strategically and wisely, then renounce your past. Renounce your past. Look what he says in verse 3. For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do. So the Gentiles were outsiders, right? Represented people who didn't know God. And this is what they did. This is how they lived. They lived in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, lawless idolatry, right? And here's essentially what Peter is saying to us. I think it's pretty straightforward. And I'm not even going to go through and explain what each of these words means. I think it's pretty straightforward. I think Peter is saying this. It is a waste of time to live in the past. It is a waste of time to continually get tripped up by your past sins. And that's what happens to a lot of us. We say, you know what? I give my life to Christ, and then we never move forward. We never mature. We never grow. We continually get stuck in the past. And I think Peter's saying, listen, like enough is enough. Be the new you, not the old you, right? Stop living like everyone else around you. Like, stop being dominated by sin, right? So I think his point is that we've all wasted enough time doing sinful things. How many of you would agree with that? Like, we've all wasted enough time, like, doing sinful things. Like, I could go back and track my, like, high school years into early college and just wasted so much time doing sinful things that amounted to absolutely nothing and set me back at every single turn. And Peter's like, listen, now that you're in Christ, man, time to move on. Time to grow up, time to mature. It's time to move on towards godliness, right? So count your past as past. And so I think he's trying to say to us, you shouldn't be doing the same things, living the same way that you used to live now that you know the person of Jesus Christ. So don't waste your time doing the things that you used to do before you met the person of Jesus Christ. And then finally, Peter says, listen, If you want to spend your time wisely and strategically, you do what? You decide that you're going to reach the lost. And so when you resist sin, when you relish and run after God's will, when you renounce your past and stop living in your past and being tripped up by your past sins, look at what he says in verse 4. He says, there are going to be a lot of people who turn on you. And not only turn on you, but malign you. I think a lot of times people don't give their life to Jesus Christ because there is a fear about what the pre-Christian community that you used to run with might say or think or do. How many of you know what I'm talking about? It's kind of like, man, I see this Jesus thing super appealing to me, but what would my best friend say? Like, what would my friend say at home, right? What would my family say? And so it inhibits us then from like moving forward and actually trusting in the person of Jesus Christ. Look at what he says in verse 4. With respect to this being, if you resist sin, run after God's will, renounce your past, there are going to be people malign you. Look what he says. With respect to this, they're actually surprised when you don't join them in the same kind of lifestyle. The same flood of debauchery is the language that he uses, right? And they malign you. So they're going to be super frustrated that you don't live like them anymore, so much so that they're going to malign your new way of living. And so here's what everyone in this place needs to understand, right? Unbelievers don't understand when God changes a life. Like, they don't get it. They don't understand it. Chances are they're going to talk negatively about you. Because the world thinks it's strange when people don't wreck their lives with drugs and end up with hangovers. They think it's strange when people don't wreck their homes with infidelity and immorality. They think it's strange when an addict becomes sober or the impure becomes pure. They just don't have a category for how God changes people, right? And so what do? If they don't understand it, what do? They criticize it. They malign it. And they're going to malign you. But Peter's like, listen, don't get discouraged by that. God wants to use you, your new life, to open their eyes to his grace and his forgiveness. And so he's like, listen, be the gospel to them. Share good news with them. Because you know something about them that they don't even know about themselves. Look in verse 5. You know this, that they're going to give an account to him who's what? Who's ready to judge the living and the dead. Let me tell you what verse 5 means. Verse 5 essentially means that no one is getting by with anything. That ungodliness does not go unnoticed and ultimately unpunished by God. How many of you believe that? Because you can start to think, man, people are getting away with everything here. Like, I'm being godly and I'm getting hammered. This person isn't godly and they're getting away scot-free. You can start to think those things until you read verses like this to tell you, no. There's a judge who's ready to judge the living and the dead. So like Jesus is ready to judge everyone who has rejected him. He's also ready to judge everyone who has maligned you and abused you, right, along the way. Now, I want you to notice that at the end of verse 5, Peter says something. This kind of struck me. I think we all think, well, yeah, Jesus is going to judge the living, but judging the dead, what does that actually mean? Because he says what? That judgment actually follows believers into death. So here's what I think Peter is saying here. I think Peter is saying that no one can say, you know what? I lived however I want to live, however I wanted to live. I did whatever I wanted to do. I said no to Christ. I rejected Christ. And I got off the hook by dying. God never judged me while I was living. I beat it. I got off the hook here by dying. And Peter's like, oh no. Let me tell you something about God. God judges the dead too, and he determines their eternal status in heaven or hell. And so Peter's telling us here that death doesn't stop God's judgment, right? On the contrary, as verse 6 says, and this is a super confusing verse, so I'm going to try to explain it here. Look at what he says. For this is why the gospel was preached even to those who are dead, that though judged in the flesh the way people are, like everyone's judged, they might live in the spirit the way God does. So pay attention to the wording here, okay? Peter says that the gospel was preached, past tense, not the gospel will be preached to those who are dead. This is not a proof text that we can utilize to say that once you're dead, then you can be saved. Let me be clear. There is no salvation in store for anyone after death. You do know that there are certain religions who will study their genealogies, their family trees, and will find certain people in their family tree where they don't know for certain whether or not they trusted Christ or not, and they will be baptized, right, on behalf of the dead. Essentially trying to preach the gospel to the dead. The Bible says this, there's no need to preach the gospel in a cemetery, right? There's no need, right? There's no need for post-death evangelism. Peter's point, however, is that unbelievers, think about this, unbelievers can't say to believers, ah, you die just like we die. Why trust Jesus if we all end up dead anyway? But Peter's like, no, that is not true. That Christians face an altogether different future than non-Christians do. So when it says that the gospel was preached even to those who are dead, it means that Christians carry the gospel into death. In that way, death is not at all the same for believers and unbelievers. How many of you understand that? It's not at all the same for believers and unbelievers, not in the least. The Bible says that judgment follows unbelievers into death and hell, while life follows believers into death, obviously landing us eternally in heaven. And so he's trying to say, no, don't get played by this lie that in the end everybody dies. Who knows what happens after people die? No. If you've trusted in the person of Jesus Christ, the good news of the gospel is this. That gospel follows you into death. How many of you are glad to know that? So there's good news when you die. Here's the good news. You'll die, but you won't stay dead. Like, I'm into living. How many of you are really into living? I like living. And I know my time here is limited, but I know if I trust in the person of Jesus Christ, I get introduced to eternal life where I don't have any limitations on my time any longer. And so I think what Peter is trying to get us to do is like, hey, time is short. Time is short. It really is. And you need to take seriously this commodity of time. And in this short window of time that you have, you're wasting your time, and then you're going to set up not only this life for futility, but you're going to set up the next life for judgment and eventually punishment and hell forever. So he's like, man, you're in this moment in time. Take advantage of the time that you have. So if you're a Christ follower, here's how you should spend your time. You're like, what do I do with my time? All this time. Here's what you do. You resist sin. And then when you suffer, right, when you go through hardship, let suffering help you. Use that suffering as leverage to help you reprioritize what's really important in life so that you stop wasting time, right? Run towards God's will. Like, God, I want to know what you want for me. I want to walk, right, in step with the Spirit. Renounce your past, right? And then reach the lost around you. Amazing ways to spend your time. That's living with wisdom, right? That's making your life count for eternity. And then I would say this, for those of you yet to believe in Jesus, let me just say this. Time is not on your side. It's not on your side. Here's the truth. No one in this place is in control of time. No one is. We keep track of it, right? But no one's in control of it. And so I've thought a lot about this. Especially when I was younger, I started thinking a lot about time, and you start seeing people around you die, and you start seeing, man, that that life ends. Sometimes it's abruptly. When I was growing up, I remember being in sixth grade and had a classmate and her younger brother get killed in a car wreck. And I got confronted, like, as a 12-year-old, that time can be over, like, in a hurry. And that's what I think the Bible does with time, that you have time, but don't play around with it. Like, be urgent with it. And that's why, listen, if you've not trusted in the person of Jesus Christ, here's how the Bible talks about that. Do it today. What does it say? Today. 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 Today is what? Today is the day of salvation. Why do you think the Bible does that? Because the Bible is screaming to all of us, we're not in control of time. You don't know when your last breath will be, nor do I. And so it's like, we got this commodity called time. Let's take advantage of the time that we have to say yes to the person of Jesus Christ. And once we have said yes to him, let's resist sin. Let's run after God's will. Let's renounce our past. And let's spend our time reaching lost people around us. Because if you're a Christ follower, you know time is short. Time is short. How many of you are surprised that you're as old as you are? How many of you look in the mirror on occasion and go, who is that? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so I've been here about 13, 14 years now, and I went back this week and looked at what I looked like when I came here versus what I look like now. It's like a completely different pastor is pastoring Grace Church right here and right now. And you know what it does? It's like, man, time just flies by. And so I look at myself in the mirror and I go, man, who is this? What's happened? Where did it all go, right? Everything's changing. And it is for you too. It is for you too. Man, time is short. And I know when you're young, you're like, man, I don't buy it. Well, here's what's going to happen. You're going to wake up and you're going to be 50 one day. And you're going to remember this message. You're going to remember this dude up here going, you're going to remember all that. And I hope you do. Amen. Yeah, I hope you do, right? I hope you do. Because we got a lot of people just playing around. A lot of people not taking time seriously. And God is saying, no, you got this amazing commodity called time. You got so much of it. Spend it wisely. Spend it strategically. And then make sure you spend it in such a way that you're helping lead other people to eternity. Make sure, but you know how and when you're going to spend eternity. And so today, listen, if you have never given your life to Jesus Christ, like, what does that even mean? Here's what it means. It means that you realize that God has created the heavens and the earth. It means that you realize, like, man, sin entered into the world and there's sin everywhere, right? That you have sin in your own heart, you have sin in your own life. But you realize that God loves you so much that he wanted to deal with this deal breaker with him called sin. And so here's what he did. Here's how he dealt with that. He sent his son Jesus Christ to leave heaven, come to earth, and then die on a cross. Not for his sins, but for your sins and for my sins. And so Jesus takes our sins, dies upon the cross for us. The Bible says that he's buried. And then on the third day, God raises him from the dead, right? Declaring him, establishing him as the savior of all humanity. So it means for you and for me that, like, we can't save ourselves, right? We can't do enough good things, stop doing enough bad things that God would somehow look at us and go, okay, that'll suffice. He looks at us like, no, there's nothing you can do. There's nothing you got that will warrant me giving you salvation. So here's what you have to do. You have to trust in what Jesus Christ has done and who he is, not in who you are and what you do. Big shift. And so the Bible says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And so think about this gift. So you're saying, well, there's this gift. It's called salvation. Then all I have to do is by faith receive this gift into my life. It's exactly what I'm saying. That Jesus Christ has done all the work, so you don't have any work to do but trust in the work that he's done. Does that make sense? That's why it's a free gift of salvation that he offers to us. And then he positions it like this. Today's the day, man. Today's the day. And so if you can guarantee me, and maybe, man, you go home and it's all cool. Remember I kind of told you I kind of grew up in a church where, you know, the pastor was always kind of tying these dying dog stories on the end of every sermon. Where it'd be like, you know, you'll get killed in a car wreck on the way home. I was always like, oh, I'm never trying to manipulate you like that. Not. But I do want you to know how important this is. That today is the day. And this is a moment in time for you to say yes to Jesus Christ. And so if you've not done that, here's what you can do. You could admit that you're a sinner. You can believe by faith that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins. And you can say, Jesus, I want you to come into my life today. I commit my life to you today. Amen? So I'm going to lead you in a little guided prayer here, right here, right now. If you've never trusted in the person of Jesus Christ, you're like, man, I want that. I feel the urgency in doing this today. And if you feel that, you want to pray this, okay? If you don't feel that, man, I trust God's going to work with you, right, communicate to you, lead you, guide you. But if you feel like, man, I feel the today-ness here, I want to do something about it today. And I'm going to lead you in this prayer right now, all right? So you pray this, you mean this in your heart. Say, God, I know that your word says today is the day of salvation. And so today I want to turn from my sin, and I want to trust in who Jesus Christ is and what Jesus Christ has done on the cross. I believe that Jesus died for me, and that he was buried, and that he was raised to new life in 3 days. And so, Jesus, would you come into my life right now, and would you save me and give me the gift of eternity? Thank you for loving me. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for this amazing gift. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would stand with me, we're gonna worship together. And then I would say this, like, if you have prayed and you've trusted in the person of Jesus Christ today, man, you gotta let somebody know. Let me know, let us know. We got a prayer room, man. There'll be people that will come alongside you. And you can just tell them, listen, I gave my life to Jesus Christ today. Today was the day of salvation for me. And man, we'll encourage you, kind of help you with next steps, kind of what to do after you've trusted in the person of Jesus Christ. Amen? But let's worship together. And man, you let someone know today if you've given your heart to the person of Jesus Christ.
Hey man, this is a newer song for us. I've only done it once before, but I just felt like it just goes so well with the passage that we are in, that we are not to be of this world, but instead we are set apart. So these words are challenging and encouraging and convicting, and so I pray that just as we sing, Christ will be honored.
Back to our first love, nothing between us. And back to your heart, to the start of it all, where we found you. And out of the ashes, into the fire, you are refining our hearts in the flames of your presence. Set apart for our God above, set apart for the one we love, set apart for your glory, we are yours, yours. The sacred and holy, worthy. So Jesus, awaken hearts now to be your revival. We are young.
The way we speak, the way we serve, the way we give, the way we obey, all for the glory of God. So good to have you here today. We're going to continue in worship this morning as we give. If you've come this morning prepared to give, you'll find giving stations at all of our exits and entrances. If you're watching online, you can give at grace.church/give. You can also give on the app. And it's an act of worship unto God if you've come prepared to give today. Your giving allows us to continue to share the gospel across the street and around the world. And Lord willing, we're going to continue around the world in 2022, in particular, January of 2022. We're inviting the church to come to Africa, all right? We do some trips that are smaller, and then we say, hey, this is an all-church trip. January 2022, don't miss it. If you're new to Grace, this is a great way to connect with some people. If you've been at Grace for a long time, you've heard us talk about these trips for years, this is the one to do. January of 2022, don't miss it. Fantastic ministry model that we take over there and partner with our brothers and sisters in Nairobi and another village right outside of Nairobi. Don't miss it. We're going to have an informational meeting on February 28th, 12 p.m. right after this service, February 28th. Quick info meeting. You'll see more information online. Don't miss Kenya 2022. You can get more information at grace.church/Kenya. And again, if you're new to Grace, it's a great way for you to get plugged in. If you're new to Grace here today, very first time, we want to especially welcome you. If you're watching online for the first time, thanks for joining us. You can go to grace.church/new for more information about Grace, or you can meet some from our Guest Central team right over here by door 4. We'd love to meet you, answer any questions that you might have about Grace. We don't take it lightly that you are here, and we'll help you get connected. Let's stand together as we get ready to close. If you're ready to say yes to Jesus today, Pastor Troy talked about that. That's just stirring in your heart. You're ready to say yes to Jesus today. Love to talk to you about that. Love to pray with you today. All right? Come down to the front. Some from our ministry team will be down here. We'll pray for you over in our prayer room right to your left underneath the screen there. If you're watching online, you can go to grace.church/prayer and we will pray for you. Let's pray together right now. We love you, Jesus. We praise you. We thank you that we could gather today. Help us to represent you well as we leave this place today. All for your glory, set apart for your glory. We pray it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. See you later.